కోరుతారని విషయవారి స్వరూప కోరుతారని ఆయన పాత్రలో ఉంటారు. ఆయన కోరుతారని అంత అందరూ సంస్థ సంబంధించాలి అను అందరూ హింసాగే స్థితిగా కోరుతారని గబూజ్ అంశాలే తెలియదా. గబూజ్ బహుశాయి కావుతే అమెరికాయి కావుతుంది
Valla, e poi ci alzano anche gli attacchi.
Ուղղակիերեն հաղորդումը դիգալարը ուժուղար ուշացանի հարցերը։ Ամենի չերկան են, ասեմ որ հարցազույցը դիգիտել է մոտ 45 վարկյան պեղին վրա, և ակե երկան 30 վարկյան արեմ դիգիտելի ծեզի, որ հարցում է հարցրեք, բայց ոչ է համանոր գերվով, այլ թուղթեր դրամատում գրնակ մոց վրա ծեղացումները կրել հայերեն կամ ախտերեն հիվատրկերեն ասեմ չատերը կիտերատատերը Նեթորանակ հայերենի ամոր շատ դուզվանությունի հայերենի և ախտերենի մեջ դրտակրտերը կամատրանությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությությու
vatanda bir arada yaşama hukukunu oluşturmaya çalışan vekillerimizi tanıtmaya çalışacağım. Bakın Kirikor Zohrab, İstanbul mebusu. Bedros Halaçyan, İstanbul mebusu. Nazaret Davaryan, Sivas mebusu. Garabet Paşayan, Sivas mebusu. Ohannes Serengülyan, Erzurum mebusu. Omnik Tersekyan, Van mebusu. Hampartun Boyacıyan, Kozan mebusu. Bahan Papazyan, Van mebusu. Hagop Babikyan, Tekirdağ mebusu. Karakin Pastırmacıyan, Erzurum mebusu. Keam Dergarabetyan, Muş mebusu. Hagop Boyacıyan, Tekirdağ mebusu. Artin Boşgezenyan, Halep mebusu. Bunlar demokratik siyasetle bir arada yaşama irademizi savunuyorlardı ve onların Osmanlılık rüyalarına ihanet edildi. Demokratik siyasete ihanet edildi. Şimdi Türkiye Büyük Millet Meclisi bu mebuslarımızın hatırasına saygı gereği onların akıbetleriyle ilgili bir araştırma komisyonu oluşturmalıdır. Hepsinin anısının önünde saygıyla eğiliyorum. Atsvat İrent Hokin Lusabore.
Metiner otur ben. Metiner'e bak Metiner. Ortalığı karıştırma Metiner. Metiner. Metiner. Thank you.
First of all, thank you for being here to welcome, support, and honor a two-year-old nomination. A man who, using cliches, not only talks the talk but walks the walk, as you just saw. I don't have much to add. I think that speaks for itself. A man who 100 years later brought back and honored his colleagues, elected Armenian members of the parliament 100 years after they were all killed. A man who speaks truth to power. You heard that was not in the script, the heckling that he was being subjected to as he went through each picture, each name, and the region that they represented. And of course, a couple of months later, or less than a month later, he was subjected to physical violence on the floor of the parliament. And you've heard, of course, from John Kosakian. Thank you, John, for all the kind and generous words. So I'm not going to add, because it's been a long day, and I want... What we have is a question-answer session, as has been told, and I will first introduce the person who will be asking the questions, another true gem and star of our nation. And I will call him to the podium after I read his biography. Harchis Muradyan is the Henry S. Hanzadyan Kazan visiting professor at CSU Fresno for the fall 2016 semester, and a visiting scholar at the Center for the Study of Genocide and Human Rights, CGHR, at Rutgers University, where he also serves as the coordinator of the Armenian Genocide Program. In 2015 and 16, Muradyan was a visiting assistant professor at the Division of Global Affairs at Rutgers University. Since 2014, Muradyan has taught courses on imperialism, mass violence, human rights, concentration camps, urban space, and conflict in the Middle East and collective memory in the history and sociology departments at Rutgers and at Worcester State University. Muradyan holds a PhD in history from the Strasser Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies at Clark University and a graduate certificate in conflict resolution from UMass Boston. He is the author of several articles and book chapters, and is the recipient of the first Ferrahian Spirit of Freedom and Justice Medal of the Organization of Istanbul Armenians. He has made 24 trips to Turkey, researching historic Armenian towns and villages since 2010. So it's my great honor to welcome to his chair, Professor Murad. Of course, our guest of honor doesn't need introductions, but we like things the right way, so just bear with me. Member of Parliament, representative from People's Democratic Party, HDP, and a member of the Parliamentary Committees on Constitution and Budget, two very important committees. Garo Paylan is a founding member of People's Democratic Party and is a deputy representing the 3rd District of Istanbul. Mr. Paylan is also a member of Turkey's Armenian community and has long been an activist on human rights, Kurdish and Armenian issues. Previous to joining the parliament, Mr. Paylan served in the Central Committee of HDP and also served on the management of all Armenian schools in Istanbul, 5 high schools, 4 elementary schools. He has long promoted bilingual education and minority rights in Turkey and has been actively engaged in raising the awareness on discrimination towards minorities, the rights of the Armenian community in Turkey, Turkish-Armenian reconciliation, and especially on Ferrahian murder case. Mr. Paylan is from a family originally from Malatya and is one of the three Armenian deputies in the Turkish parliament. It's my great honor, and please give him one more great welcome. Garo.
Are the mics working? Okay, I'd like to start without further ado and introductions and general comments. You're here to listen to Garo. My questions are generally going to, I'm going to start from general, from the current situation in Turkey, recent developments, and try to dig deeper into some of the agenda of the HDP, Garo's position, his role. We're going to talk a little bit about the Armenian community, other minorities in Turkey, challenges facing them, and ask some other questions within the broader context of Turkey, Syria, the region, and its implications. And in the second half of the Q&A session, we're going to have questions provided by you, and I'm going to read the questions, Garo is going to answer them, and that concludes our evening. So Garo, thank you again for being with us. I'd like to start with the situation in Turkey. Over the past few months, developments, whether it's the situation in Syria and Turkey's involvement in it, the situation in the southeast, particularly the attacks by the conflict in the southeast between the PKK and the Turkish military, and the recent coup, essentially frame some of the three major developments in Turkey today, and create this dark cloud over Turkey that has probably slowed, if not stopped, years of hard work by individuals like you who have worked hard for democracy, justice, equality. Give us an assessment of all this.
Okay. Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. Harikisher. Eschat Urahem or Hosem, as Yev Hantibetsang Mias Nabar. First of all, I have to give an explanation for the language, like I did this morning. My roots are from Malatya, and my parents have moved to Istanbul, and I was born in 1972 in Istanbul in a Turkish spoken house. And my mother tongue is Turkish. I went to the Armenian school, to the kindergarten, and later the elementary school. And afterwards, I went to high school, but it was not an Armenian school. In the high school, that's why my Armenian is not perfect, but I understand very well, but to give a presentation, it's not enough to give a presentation, unfortunately. But with Tamar, my staff, advisor, we will really work on it. But we didn't have time because of the chaos in Turkey. After I became the deputy, everything harnamaz in Turkey, like my language. And this is the English that I have from the high school. And I will try my best in English. I spoke hundreds of times in Turkish, but my English is not perfect at all, but I will try my best. So let's go back to the question. Let's divide the question. Is it okay? First
yes.
of all, let's give some explanations about Turkey, what is going on, if you don't mind.
Absolutely. Go ahead.
Then we can go yes. to Syria yes. and Syrian policy. Turkey has never been a democracy, a total democracy. We had dark days and some good days, some romantic days. We sometimes had hopes, and somehow that those hopes have sometimes, or most of the times, have demolished. And but this is this time today. These days are the one of the darkest days of Turkey's history. Yes, we lived a coup attempt, which was a real one. Some of you might have concerns about it, but it was a real coup attempt. I'm so happy that it didn't succeed. But before the coup, we already had a coup, which was driven by our president, Recep Tayyip Erdogan. After the corrupt files that happened in 1725, December 2013, he just had a coalition with the Gulenists. But the Gulenists, with this power struggle game, they betrayed each other. And Tayyip Erdogan just said, there is no coalition anymore, and you're my enemy. He's an opportunist, and he...
He has made 24 trips to Turkey, researching historic Armenian towns and villages since 2010. So it's my great honor to welcome to his chair, Professor Murat. Garo Paylan is a founding member of the People's Democratic Party and is a deputy representing the 3rd district of Istanbul. Mr. Paylan is also a member of Turkey's Armenian community and has long been an activist on human rights, Kurdish and Armenian issues. Previous to joining the parliament, Mr. Paylan served in the Central Committee of HDP and also served on the management of all Armenian schools in Istanbul. 5 high schools or elementary schools. He has long promoted bilingual education and minority rights in Turkey and has been actively engaged in raising the awareness on discrimination towards minorities, the rights of the Armenian community in Turkey, Turkish-Armenian reconciliation, and especially on granting murder case. Mr. Paylan is from a family originally from Malatya, and is one of the 3 Armenian deputies in the Turkish parliament. It's my great honor, and please give him one more great welcome. Garo Paylan.
Mic's working. Okay, I'd like to start without further ado and introductions and general comments. You're here to listen to Garo. My questions are generally going to, I'm going to start from general, from the current situation in Turkey, recent developments, and try to dig deeper into some of the agenda of the HDP. Garo's position, his role. We're going to talk a little bit about the Armenian community, other minorities in Turkey, challenges facing them, and ask some other questions within the broader context of Turkey, Syria, the region, and its implications. And in the second half of the Q&A session, we're going to have questions provided by you, and I'm going to read the questions, Garo is going to answer them, and that concludes our evening. So Garo, thank you again for being with us. I'd like to start with the situation in Turkey. Over the past few months, developments, whether it's the situation in Syria and Turkey's involvement in it, the situation in the southeast, particularly the attacks by the conflict in the southeast between the PKK and the Turkish military, and the recent coup, essentially frame some of the 3 major developments in Turkey today, how and create this dark cloud over Turkey that has probably slowed, if not stopped, years of hard work by individuals like you have worked hard for democracy, justice, equality. Give us an assessment of all this.
Okay. Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. Harikisher. Es çaturahem vor hosem es yev hantibetsan miastapar First of all, I have to give an explanation for the language, like I did this morning. My roots are from Malatya, and my parents have moved to Istanbul, and I was born in 1972 in Istanbul in a Turkish spoken house, and my mother tongue is Turkish. I went to the Armenian school, to the kindergarten, and later the elementary school, and afterwards I went to high school, but it was not an Armenian school. In the high school, that's why my Armenian is not perfect, but I understand very well, but to give a presentation, it's not enough to give a presentation, unfortunately. But with Tamar, my staff, advisor, we will really work on it. But we didn't have time because of the chaos in Turkey. After I became the deputy, everything was in Turkey. Like my language. And this is the English that I have from the high school. And I will try my best in English. I spoke hundreds of times in Turkish, but my English is not perfect at all, but I will try my best. So let's go back to the question. Let's divide the question. Is it okay? First of all, let's give some explanations about Turkey, what is going on, if you don't mind.
Absolutely.
Then we can go to Syria and Syrian policy. Turkey has never been a democracy, a total democracy. We had dark days and some good days, some romantic days. We sometimes had hopes, and somehow that those hopes have sometimes, or most of the times, have demolished. And but this is this time today. These days are one of the darkest days of Turkey's history. Yes, we lived a coup attempt, which was a real one. Some of you might have concerns about it, but it was a real coup attempt. I'm so happy that it didn't succeed. But before the coup, we already had a coup, which was driven by our president, Recep Tayyip Erdogan. After the corrupt files that happened in 1725, December 2013, he just had a coalition with the Gulenists. But the Gulenists, with this power struggle game, they betrayed each other. And Tayyip Erdogan just said, there is no coalition anymore, and you're my enemy. He's an opportunist, and he easily changes his friends. And he made another coalition with the old deep state, because he didn't have any other force. And we know that power is bad. We had hopes in the first period of AKP that they had conflict with that idea, with that ideology that was driven by mostly the military. That sociology had conflicts with that conservative sociology had conflict with the state ideology, with that headscarf thing and the problems with the Muslim identity. But the more Erdogan got power, he of course started with a group of friends that, let's say, Democrat Muslims, we called them, and we had hopes with them. But the more he got power, he got rid of his friends. He stepped over them, and he played with Gulenists. Now he doesn't have the Gulenists. He's the only one. He's the one man, like Putin, unfortunately, in the Middle East. This is so popular, like Egypt, we had the coup. And everywhere, the Arab Spring has demolished, and everywhere, there are dictators again. Also in India, we have Modi. In the world, there is something like this. I hope we don't. We won't have the Trump here. Sorry about the Trump followers. But as I said, the more Erdogan got the power, he just betrayed his friends, because most of his friends wanted that democratic process. Because all of the sociology suffered because of this ideology. Of course, we suffered. Why are you here? My relatives, my friends, everybody. As I know, you are like my neighbors, you are like my relatives in Istanbul, all the same. And in LA, I see you really follow Turkey and what is going on in Turkey, and you really keep your culture here. I'm very proud of it, and I'm very happy to see this. But you are so far away from your land, and we suffered genocide, of course. We stayed in Turkey, and my relatives are sitting there, my cousins, my uncles are sitting there, and they couldn't live in their motherland. Everybody suffered, and we, because of this ideology has still going on. 100 years ago, we suffered the genocide, and unpunished crimes lead to new crimes. Now, it was us 100 years ago, and 100 years later, it is the Kurds now. They are suffering. They ask for local governments, and that, like we asked 100 years ago, local democracy, autonomy. But the response of the state is so harsh, like 100 years ago. They are demolishing the cities. 20 years ago, it was the villages. Now it is the cities. I don't know if you are just watching that, what is happening in Sur, Cizre, which used to be the Armenian land as well. They are demolishing, bombing those cities, and about 500,000 people are displaced in a year. And at least 8,000 people were killed, an average every day 50. And it is not a new, unfortunately, in the Western world, because it is normalized. Every day 500 people are dying in Syria. It is normalized. And Europe and USA has a blind eye on it, the human rights violations. The more the West has a blind eye, the more we suffer, the Democrats, let's say, in the Middle East, in Turkey, in Syria. And I'm always asking, where are the values of the West? Where are the human rights ideology? But there is no response, and there is no strong, there is no one who says stop to Erdogan. I really see Mr. Biden next to Erdogan smiling. I see two of his teeth last week when he is just shaking his hand. It's no good. When I see that, I see he is only cares about the interests. But to work with the dictators, really, is going to make big crimes to humanity again. And like you see in North Korean leader, you say he is crazy. Erdogan is not that clever as well. And he does terrible things. He's behaving like a dictator, and whoever criticizes Erdogan is in jail or in grave. And in a year, from my party, HDP, 5,000 politicians are in jail. And they appointed governors, deputy governors, to the municipalities instead of our chosen mayors. And our mayors are in the prison as well. And they raised our immunity, as you know, that fight, I was beaten in the parliament. We were saying that this is not true, you shouldn't do that. We have to protect the legal democracy. But they lifted our immunity. And in the following days, they might arrest some of or most of our deputies, because they have cases and they can easily put our deputies in the jail like 100 years ago. Kirkor Zohrab, as one of our friends said, when he was taken to the jail, he said, "I have the immunity." And the policeman said, "So what?" That is all like this. And we really had hopes about the peace process. And we took the advantage, we the Armenians, I say, took the advantage of the peace process. But again, we are living the darkest days of the Turkey's history.
Garo, things were not like this, even at least over the past several years. And your party initiated a series of efforts to change the culture and politics and the environment in Turkey, whether it's multiculturalism in certain regions, whether it's a different way of doing politics. Can you talk a little bit about this?
Of course. Let's say, when I was born, I had my grandmother in our home. And I was asking to my grandmother, "Where is your mother? Where is your father?" And I just found the answer in the following years, and I heard that we had the genocide. And afterwards, I became one of the board members of an Armenian school, and I was the coordinator of the Armenian schools, the project coordinators. And I saw so many crimes have been done to our people, to our foundations, to our patriarchy. And when I saw that, I gave this struggle for the Armenian community. But for years, for at least 20 years, I gave this struggle. But to only care about your identity is a disease. I can say that, disease. And I had friends in Turkey, the Kurds, the Democrat Kurds, let's say, or Democrat Turks. Democrats, let's say, Alawis or Sunnis, some Muslims as well, Democrat Muslims. And I found them, and we tried to care about each other's problems. Then, 6 years ago, when we were to organize the commemoration in the Taksim Square, we were only three. And we were speaking about the organization, and the Armenians were saying, or some of our friends, "Are you crazy? They are going to kill you if you do that." But those Kurds who are Democrats, those Turks, or those Muslim Democrats said, we will be around you. Don't worry, let's do this commemoration. They gave us that courage. And they cared about us, and they were there when that commemoration happened. And it was very important. I saw that they cared about our wound, and that day, some part of my wound has healed. And afterwards, I became more into them, and I cared about their problems. The Kurdish conflict, the LGBT problem, conflict, and the gender problem, and every kind of, every means equality, let's say. I was with them. And we found each other in the 2011 elections. In that elections, we really gave important struggle against the system and asked for democracy with every kind of identity. And afterwards, we said we have to establish a party. What kind of a party it can be? Because we had the no conservatives party, which is AKP. The most, only 99% of the voters are conservative. We have CHP, mostly the secular ones, or the Alevis vote for that party. And we have MHP, which is the nationalist party, only the nationalists vote for that. And we have the Kurdish party, which was BDP. All about, you know, diversity, and we said we have to establish a party which is everybody's party. Who are Democrats? Our first word is to be a Democrat. And Democrat Armenians, Democrat Kurds, Democrat, let's say, Muslims, and gender, who are feminists, and LGBT, who are giving for LGBT rights. Those people came together and worked for months. This party has to be everybody's party who is Democrat. And we established that party. I am one of the founders of my party, and I'm proud of it. My party is pro-gender party. My party believes in equality. But it is not only just saying equality. Really, my party believes in equality. And my party is pro-labor party. I can say it is, let's say, real leftist, because CHP says I am leftist. They are not at all. They are, in these days we see that they are behaving like AKP when it comes to Kurds, when it comes to Armenians, unfortunately. So we established a party. The diversity makes people hate each other, and they have deep concerns about Kurds, and Kurds have deep concerns about Turks, Armenians have concerns about everybody, you know, as you know. And we said we have to work on it, and we have to give that courage to everybody, and people believed in us. We had only 6% in the 2011, and in the presidential elections we had 10% by Selahattin Demirtas. You might remember our co-chair. We have the co-chair. One has to be woman, one has to be man. And in every board, in every committee, there has to be at least 50% of the committee has to be woman. At least. Like our committee, is it? So, really, to give a struggle for peace is very harsh, is very hard. So, because in the Middle East, these kinds of struggles are so hard. Because in the Middle East, people can't solve their problems for 100 years, and there are huge polarizations, deep polarizations, unfortunately. And we really succeeded. People just opened their ear to us. We had 13% of the votes in the last year's June elections. And what is more important to that, at least 60% said, due to the vote pools, I'm ready to vote for HDP. I can vote for HDP. It doesn't mean that they will vote, but they are open to hear us. But the state didn't like it, because we wanted the state to change, but the ones who didn't want the change, who didn't want the, let's say, local democracy or gender equality or labor rights or everything, as I said, saw this as a threat. And Erdogan lost power. he couldn't establish the government by himself, and he said, there is no peace process anymore. There is no peace process. And he started the war. There, two police officers were killed in their house, and he said, PKK has killed those two police officers. That is why the planes are going to bomb Kandil. And after that day, as I said, 8,000 people have been killed. And when we don't have a peace process, people die, and at least 1,000 soldiers and police officers have been killed. And the Turks became nationalist again, more nationalist, and Kurds became more nationalist. And the war is going on, and the Armenians, again, what they feel is the fear. They are asking to each other, telling each other that, do we have a future here in Turkey? Do we have a future? Because they saw Halep. People from Halep came to Turkey, and I have those refugees. Thousands of refugees came to Turkey, just a bridge, you know. Not, most of them didn't stay in Turkey, but it was like a bridge. They went to Armenia and Europe and America, Canada. Some of them, about 1,000 of them, are in Turkey. And they were telling that there was a war, some part of Syria, and we didn't care about it. We said those kind of wars can happen. And 2 months later, the war was in front of our home. And we could also only take our jackets and ran away. And now we see, out of 100,000 Armenians, now we have only 10,000, something or less, Armenians. And our Armenian community in Turkey feels that fear as well, and they don't see their future in Turkey. Let's say, sorry about it. Yes.
No, I wanted to follow up on this and talk about the fear factor. But before, can you talk a little bit about HDP's policies towards minorities in general, but specifically also towards the Armenians? A lot has happened.
Okay. As I said, HDP cares about all the identities who suffer. And of course, we are a minority, but the HDP knows, especially the Kurds know now. They didn't know that 50 years ago, because they were swearing at us. But when they suffered in the 80s and 90s, they saw that what happened to Armenians 100 years ago, the same thing is happening to us. They saw that. And now they have that empathy. And the Kurdish independence, Kurdish movement really understood that, and they recognize the genocide. And especially our co-chairs, Figen Yüksekdağ and Selahattin Demirtaş, every year just says that they feel sorry about the genocide, and with the genocide word, not only they are using the genocide word. And our party, always our party members, our deputies, co-chairs, attend to the commemorations. But they, one of them attended to the Kranagert and the other to Istanbul. The only party, I'm proud of my party, that they recognize the genocide. And they are one of the followers of the Granting case, and Sevak Balıkçı. Let's not forget about him, Sevak Balıkçı. And it's not all about me. That is very important, you know. This next Monday, we have the Granting trial again. Next Monday, and I won't be there. But I know at least four of our deputies will be there. That is very important, and my party is Armenian policy. And of course, we have problems about today. Our schools problem, and we come to elections for our patriarchy. Those kind of things are followed by my party as well.
And in your case, you talked about the fear aspect, right? One of the questions that you've encountered here, and I'm sure you encounter everywhere, has to do with your own security. Another question has to do with the general concerns and issues of security of the Armenian community there. Some people might think that the fact that you're so open and critical of the government and other powers in Turkey is actually a threat. So how do you deal with this general dynamic?
Here, around, I spoke to 100 people here in this Sıra, and 99 of them said, be careful, be careful, be careful. And you can't believe, every day I am hearing it at least 100 times. I don't know anything out of giving this struggle. Because to give up is a defeat. For my character, I can't do that. Of course, I care about this fear factor. As you can see, I'm not doing so much in the previous months. Nowadays, I don't do so much about a main issue, because I have to respect about that fear going on in Turkey, in Turkey's Armenians. Of course, there is a risk about me. I was telling to Hrant Dink several times, I said, please Hrant Ahbarik, I was telling the same words. But that was different, you know. Those days, in 2001, they declared that minorities are threat to our state. And on the newspapers, about the trials about Hrant Dink was a enemy to the state ideology. And that circle was always around him, all the nationalist groups and the other groups, the Gulenists, let's say, we see, or the Ergenekon side. They had a common feeling about Hrant Dink. And one saw that he's going to get killed, and the other was organizing that. They are blaming each other, but all of them were the actors of that murder. But now I don't see a point. Why are they going to do something against me? But everybody has that fear. Let's say Hrant Dink was saying so much. What about Sevak Balıkçı? What about him? He said no word about the Armenian issue. No word.
Sevak Balıkçı is the...
Do you know Sevak Balıkçı?
Yes.
Everybody knows, I guess. He said nothing about the Armenian issue, nothing about genocide, nothing about Hrant Dink. He was just a worker. That is it. But they killed him as well. So to be silent is not secure as well. In 1915, let's say some of the Armenians gave struggle. Most of them, they killed most of them. And most of our people stayed silent. Some of the people warned our communities, let's give struggle. No, we should stay silent here. What happened to them? Same thing. So to be silent is not safe, but this is what I think. Of course, I should care about that fear factor, but we shouldn't just stay silent, wait for our fate. We shouldn't.
You talked about the current situation. you talk about the importance of not staying silent. So what do you see moving forward?
Unfortunately, let's say, in the Kurdish part, which you know, the eastern side of Turkey, they say Kurdistan, we say Western Armenia, the Turks say everywhere is ours, and I say it is our common land. In the Kurdish side, they still ask for peace. That is it. Every day, the Kurds are dying. They are still asking for peace. But in the West, let's say in the Turkish side, nowadays, no NGOs, no political parties ask for peace. No. Because anybody who asks for peace for Erdogan is a terrorist. Whoever. Even he or she is a writer, an intellectual from the secular side or conservative side, doesn't matter. He or she is in prison as a terrorist. So fear factor is on the Turkish side. But for the most of the people, like 1930s Germany, is more nationalist. Everybody for four generations have been educated to be a nationalist. And to grow the nationalism, as I saw, is very easy in Turkey. Turks are silent, and with that silentness, they give way to this war to go on, unfortunately. So Tayyip Erdogan uses this war as a blanket over every conflict. So, I can say, we don't have any political party supporting peace. So I don't see any sunlight. I don't see, unfortunately. We might live darker days, but we will give this struggle. One day, we are going to win the democracy.
Garo, let's talk a little about the situation in Syria, particularly in the north. The current Turkish policy of entering the region, its effort to fight ISIS, but at the same time, trying to in fact undermine the Kurds in the region, its support of some of the radical Islamist groups. Give us an overview of this.
In Syria, there was a dictator as well. There is still Assad regime. And now we see, if you don't have a democratic system, one day your state is not safe. Your state doesn't have a future, and people suffered because of this ideology. And now, Kurds are giving that struggle. And Kurds are giving the struggle with the Assyrians, with some Armenians, and with the Arabs. Like they believe in equality, and they believe in gender equality, like the ideology we are following. They have some land, and they have more power. America, USA supported by PG, and Turkey got mad. And they had a conflict with Putin. The more the Kurds got power, Erdogan is an opportunist, as I said. He was shouting at Putin, "I'm not going to say sorry about the plane." 3 months later, he said, "I'm sorry about the plane, he crashed." And he is playing with Putin as well. He is ready to play with Assad. He is playing with Iran. Just to Kurds or other groups not to have more power. But because they don't want this decentralization, the Syria doesn't want it, Iran doesn't want it, Turkey doesn't want it, all are centralized countries. But the Kurds or the people around that region asks for local governance, local democracy. But we are so far away from that. But the Kurds or YPG or the other groups, Syrian democratic groups, are giving this struggle. The world has to support them. You see, 100 years ago, we lost that chance. But now, 100 years later, there is one group who can really bring democracy to the Middle East. Because you can support dictators for some period, but they will make up trouble, they will be a headache to the humanity one day. So we have to support the democratic organizations. So Kurds and other Syrian democratic groups are giving that struggle, but USA and the Europe doesn't give enough support or doesn't criticize the dictators in this area, doesn't have a carrot and doesn't have a stick in their hand. And the Bush doctrine was terrible. Bush was everywhere. I'm going there, I'm going to beat this, I'm going to beat that. For 8 years, it was terrible. But Obama doctrine was also not good. I'm not going to care about that. I'm not going to care about that. It didn't work as well. So to support the democratic organizations is very important for all the democratic countries.
Not too long ago, though it feels like it was, it's been ages for that. Turkey's foreign minister talked about zero problems with neighbors. And right now, people say that we have zero neighbors with problems, without problems. So what, at some point, something went wrong here. How do you look at this? How do you explain this approach of really expansion, new Ottomanism, all this talk, and then coupled with a lot of the efforts that was happening initially with the BDP and now with your party? So what went wrong in your opinion?
Our former Prime Minister, Ahmet Davutoğlu, he believes that he's going to be, and Tayyip Erdoğan, he was going to be the leader of the Sunni world. He believes that Tayyip Erdoğan will be a sultan and I'm going to be next to him, vezir. Do you know the vezir word? I don't know. And I am in the budget committee and I know there are secret numbers in the budget, secret. And it was in 2011, it was only 30 million liras, which is $10 million in 2011. And in 2012, it became 3 billion liras, which is $1 billion. In 2014, it became 6 billion liras, which is $2 billion. And the next year again, and in 4 years, from the budget, he sent $6 billion weapons to Syria, to the jihadist groups. It is in the budget, but we can't see those numbers. They are secret. But that policy hit the wall. Just hit the wall, and Tayyip Erdoğan said, "Davutoğlu, you are out. You are dismissed. Binali, come here. Binali, we have the Binali Yıldırım now. Binali Yıldırım says our Syrian policy was wrong." And now he is working with Assad, Putin, and Iran for Kurds not to have a territory. But we say, the Turks and the Kurds, let's say, or the Turkish people, or all the identities, has to have a strategic scenario for Middle East. But again, unfortunately, as I said, the world, the West, doesn't criticize this but going, and we are facing the dictators again.
Garo, a couple more questions, and I will open up for the questions from the audience. Please write down your questions and pass them to the people who are going to pick them up from you. Let's talk a little bit about Armenia and the diaspora. You've been to several diaspora communities. You've been to Armenia. And you know, as you mentioned today, earlier today as well, the media, both in the diaspora and the Armenia, follow your moves, follow your steps. I wanted to address two things. One is, of course, this attention that you have here. But also at the same time, with this attention comes the opportunity for you to talk about some of the issues that you think could be, or you notice that could be better in some of these places that you visit. So let's first talk about your relations with Armenia, diaspora, and then some of the observations that you'd like to share with the audience.
I couldn't visit Armenia after I became a deputy, but I visited Armenia several times before. I'm so sorry that it is its 25th anniversary of the Free Armenia, but it is not it's not the Armenia that we have that those eras, those dreams. But of course, they are giving this struggle. It has conflicts in Karabakh, Azerbaijan. But the Armenians' democracy is not that strong, and the Armenians' economy is not that strong, and people are suffering. Tens of thousands of people are coming to Istanbul to work. I see them. I sometimes try to help them. And Armenia is now has lack of the population and has so many problems. But we couldn't open the border between Turkey and Armenia. It's still closed. So we can't have so much relations. But after this, Tamar is planning on November maybe or December, I will go to Armenia. I have some, with the deputies or the ministers, sometimes with them. I will visit Armenia. They are waiting for me. They are asking for me to come. Hundreds of times people are following me. But first of all, I have to really make my Armenian better, to speak their Armenian.
And how about
diaspora?
Yes.
The question was?
Mainly, you know, you visit some diaspora communities in Europe as well.
How do you see that?
Well, yes, your observations. You know, but okay. Here's the thing. My concern is this, that when you talk to people about Turkey, you tell them things that they want to hear. Okay. But I want them to hear some things that they don't want to hear.
Okay. I always feel that I am in the diaspora as well. Istanbul is not my mother territory. My mother territory is Malatya. I belong to Malatya. When I go to Malatya, I feel that. But there is so less people. Only I have two or three relatives. There are only 89 Armenians. Two more born, my cousins. 91 now, I guess. Only that much Armenians there. But still, when I go there, I feel that it is my land. Armenia is a diaspora as well. And we gathered, like you are from the Kranagard, Malatya, Harput, Elazığ, what else, I don't know, Marash. Here, you are a diaspora, and people in Istanbul, most of them are diaspora. Some people say, I'm also high. Okay, but what about your grandfathers or grand-grandfathers? Now, we came together, and we have problems in Istanbul as well. And now here, I see that, as I said, Los Angeles Armenian community is very strong and cares about their identity. But as I saw here, there is a there are divisions in the Armenian community here as well. It is very popular in the Armenian world. And we really need a leadership. We really need that. The Western Armenian world. We don't have an habitat, as I said early this morning, to naturally grow to our culture to flow in that river, naturally. We always say that we have to protect our identity. But the protect word doesn't work. It doesn't say anything to the next generation. I am the third generation after the genocide, and now I see the fourth generation as well. We can really, this can pass to the fourth generation, not 100%. But the fifth generation, they don't want to hear about protect the identity. Because they are born in a different world. And in this world, if a culture has a habitat, that culture lives. If it doesn't have a habitat, it is not going to live. So we have the Armenian. Let's say the Eastern Armenians. But most of the Armenians choose to live there. But the Western Armenians, they don't have a habitat to live, to grow their identity in a natural way. So we have to, Istanbul or other cities might be a candidate if Turkey was to be a democratic country. That was my goal. But now we are living the dark days. We have to wait for another spring. Yeah.
So do you see some of the places that you mentioned that are in today's Turkey as being part of that habitat?
Let's say if the process was to go on, the Kranegard was a as a candidate for that. The Kranegard, as you saw, they were asking for people to come back and also won as well. But the Kranegard was to be that habitat. Really.
We'll take questions from the audience, but first I'd like to invite the co-chairs for a small presentation for Garo, and then we'll continue with the last half hour of questions from the audience.
With heartfelt gratitude to Garo Paylan for the with heartfelt gratitude to Garo Paylan for his heroic efforts to advocate for justice for the Armenian genocide and the floor of the Turkish parliament, presented by the United Armenian Council of Los Angeles, September 24, 2016. Որպեսի այցելողները նաև երկրաչափորդին պատմության վրա հոսել հայ ժողովրդի 10,000 տարվա մշակույթի ֆոտոներ կան, անգլերենով քիչ մնել, որ ֆոտաներ գնան տեսնել և ճտրել։
Can I have the questions, please?
Yes.
So we will limit the questions. I understand that there's a lot. In fact, I have here more than around eight questions. We will limit the questions to five. So what I will do is I will read one question, then try to condense the others and move forward that way. Garo, you represent the 3rd district in Istanbul. What area is that? Is it an area with a large number of Armenians and other minorities? That's the main question about this process.
It is in the European side. It is around, you might know, Istanbul, Bakırköy and Yeşilköy, and those districts, of course. Half of the Armenians live there, the other half mostly lives in Şişli, the second district. I'm representing the 3rd district, but I'm representing all the Armenians and all the Kurds and all the minorities, let's say, not only the 3rd district, of course.
And so another question, did your grandparents teach you any Armenian songs or poems?
As I said, in our house, I had my grandmother, my father's mother. She was five when the genocide happened, and she knew some words, some Armenians. Of course, her mother tongue is Armenian, but she didn't use even a word. I didn't hear any Armenian from her, and she didn't teach any Armenian to my father. That is why I was born in a Turkish-spoken house, and I didn't hear any songs. I first heard the Armenian in the Nahagırtaran primary school.
Garo, there's a question here about, it says, dearest Garo, we would like to know if you have any bodyguards accompanying you in Istanbul.
Yes, I have a security guard, but Tamar is really saying that I'm not calling him so much. I have to call him to come, but I don't like. Really, I got used to go with the subway, with the bus, to everywhere. But they say you shouldn't do that. Yes, I can't do that these days. I have a security guard, a policeman. When I call him, he is with me.
There's a question in Armenian. It says, meeting with the Armenian community in America, what changes in your life through your meeting with the Armenian community? Amerika Hayatjan, Antibelov, Inch Kipohovitz, Ergan Kilmich.
I feel at home, and this surah really means that. And Hos Bach Chiga, and the other guy.
What can we Armenians of Los Angeles do to help?
To the Turkish Armenians?
In general, to help you work, the work you're doing.
What we are doing. Lobby is a famous word in Turkey. They use lobby, the diaspora, as a evil thing. But this lobby really has to give courage to the, you know, Obama administration or hopefully Clinton administration. I am a Democrat, so I have to support the election.
Yes.
Sorry about that. However, vote for Trump. to criticize Erdogan, the world has to stop Erdogan. As I said, I have to repeat that. And you have to give that courage to the administration who is going to be elected to stop Erdogan. Because the Turkish nationalism has never lived a defeat. That is why they do these kind of things. They do a crime and nothing happens. If nothing happens, they say, okay, I can go on with it. That is terrible. We can't say that it is Kurds now. We can't say that, oh, olsun. Because it is our motherland. I am sure you feel that in your heart. So our motherland has to be a good land, a democratic land. There shouldn't be blood on that land. So we have to, everybody has to give this struggle for our motherland.
Garo, let me conclude with a couple of questions. Is there any hope for the Turkish government to recognize the Armenian genocide?
No. No,
I knew that's a quick one.
So in Turkey, it is about democracy, and as you said, justice, of course. If you are a mafia leader, you do crimes, and if nobody touches you, you go on with those crimes. And it is like this. And if Turkey doesn't become a democratic country, it is not going to recognize the genocide. Forget it. And what Erdogan said yesterday, did you hear that in New York? He said, even if the America recognizes genocide, it is enters from one of my ear and exits from the other ear. I don't care about it. I don't give a shit to that. This is what he said. Why he said he's a dictator? If we have a democratic leader in our country, he's not going to say that. He can't say that. See, he was saying sorry. Let's say I'm not sorry. That was not the word. Terrible things happened in 1915 to the Armenians, to the Turks. That was important, really. That was a step forward. But now he says it's going to enter from one of my ear and exit from the other.
Garo,
that is it. The more he gets dictator, he's not going to, or Turkey is not going to recognize the genocide.
Let's conclude with one question and then another quick question that I know that the answer is going to be even quicker. First, where do you see Armenians in Turkey in the next decade, in the next 10 years?
Armenians?
In Turkey. Turkey.
In Turkey.
Where do you see them in the next 10 years?
We are around 60,000 or 70,000, as you said, but we have hundreds of thousands of Muslimized Armenians. Last year, we had the identity code, which was given by the government. Do you know about it? Our code is 2. The Greeks are 1, the Armenians are 2, the Jews were 3. And I asked to the interior minister, what is this code? Because they don't let our children to be in our school unless their codes are 2. We had so many problems. And the Muslimized Armenians are trying to turn to their identity. And they are getting baptized. Even if they are baptized, we can't take them to our schools. But nowadays, I just forced the interior minister and they lifted that code. Now we can take those Armenians to our schools. But (clears throat) There is another conflict now. We are going to decide who is Armenian, who is not. The ones who are trying to get back to their identity, our patriarchy says, Aram Sirpazan, if you are not a Christian, you are not an Armenian. But that is the word. But we shouldn't do that, I'm telling. But now we are to decide that there are discussions about that in the community, in our society, community.
And perhaps the most important question of the evening, are you single? And if, in case you are, she's asking if you are willing to marry her. So.
Where is my fiancé?
This is a blind proposal. Garo, thank you very much for your generosity with your time. I know you've been extremely, it's been an extremely hectic day, and there's another hectic day waiting for you. Thank you everyone for being here. Thank you.
Thank you.